Okay, thanks for joining us at GoldSeek.com Radio. Today's special guest, Jeffrey Nichols, Senior Economist at Rosalind Capital. It's a pleasure to welcome Jeffrey Nichols, Managing Director of American Precious Metals Advisors and Senior Economic Advisor to Rosalind Capital, Precious Metals Economist for over a quarter of a century. Welcome, Jeffrey Nichols.
Chris, nice to join you today.
We also have had your colleague, CEO Alexov, on the show this week. And I wonder if we could delve into, from an economic perspective, some of the benefits to holding precious metals. Most of our listeners are familiar with the diversification aspects and the safe haven qualities that gold and silver investments can offer to a portfolio.
Well, let me just say this. For most investors, we recommend 5 to 10% of their overall investable assets be held in the form of physical gold or gold coins. And this is irrespective of what's going on in the marketplace. At times of uncertainty, you might want to have greater exposure to gold and consider it an investment like your other investments. But I like to think of it as an insurance policy against the risks that are associated with other investment assets, dollar-denominated investments as well, because gold itself is a hedge against U.S. dollar weakness. The dollar has been very strong in the past year, but I like to think of it as other currencies being exceptionally weak rather than the dollar being strong. It's hard to imagine a positive view of the dollar given the state of the U.S. economy and the type of monetary policy and fiscal policies that we've run here in the U.S. in the last several years.
Your concept of an insurance policy I find appropriate, and this is something that we in the West, for quite some time, we've had currency stability. Yet, from the perspective of history, this is not the status quo. Currency volatility is the norm. We, I think, as a society, have a higher propensity to be blindsided by a potential currency disruption, something that very few people have prepared for. But there's another component to this story, protection from inflation. Now, while that is tied to the currency, it also has some real-world, everyday aspects that everyone is facing.
I think that it's hard to believe that the consumer price data that we see for the United States and most likely for a number of other countries is really that accurate when we, as you say, when we go to the grocery store or when we go on a vacation and take an air flight or when we pay our kids' tuition at college. It seems like the cost of living is rising much more rapidly than one would suspect from the official data. So the first thing I would say is that the data are probably inaccurate at best and don't reflect reality at the current juncture. As I said, it's hard to believe the numbers when we look at our own spending power.
You know, I've done some of my own due diligence here, and I've recalculated the CPI. And what you notice is that the government weights the housing aspect very heavily, and that has a tendency to deflate expenses. But the problem is it just doesn't reflect our real-world purchasing power very well. And then, of course, there's the component of the oil sector implosion we've seen, which has had supposedly or will have a ripple effect through the economy, lowering prices. Again, other than at the pumps, that just hasn't been the case yet. So tell us what else you're watching now, topicality that you feel is pertinent to the precious metals.
Let me go back to the insurance aspect. As I said, I like to think of gold and silver, for that matter, as insurance policies against the risks associated withholding other investment assets or bank accounts or dollar-denominated assets of all sorts. And just as you hold life insurance to protect your family or homeowners insurance in case your house has a disaster, you hope never to collect on those insurance policies because they mean you're suffering in many other ways. And it's the same thing to some extent with gold. We hope never to see the day when gold has to serve as an investment, as an insurance policy. You know, you shouldn't be disappointed because gold hasn't performed well in the last few years. In a sense, you should be glad that it hasn't, because if it had, there might be a lot of other things going on that we wouldn't be very happy about. Seeing a lot of flood damage
right
on the East Coast.
Isn't that true? And not to mention the Gulf. We have been lulled into complacency as a society. So 5 to 10% sounds like an excellent ratio, and even higher depending on your personal situation. Well, anything else that you'd like to share with the listeners today?
Well, I think it's important to state that my views on the long-term outlook for gold are extremely positive, very bullish. I think that gold will, over the next several years, rise to a multiple of recent prices, and that anybody who buys gold with a long-term, multi-year scenario will be very happy a few years down the road. I think that in the near term, gold prices, in a sense, are at a bargain. But that doesn't mean we might not go lower before we ultimately go higher. The gold market in the last few years has been characterized by selling of gold-related instruments and the gold market of late has been dominated by selling by institutional speculators and traders. And this means mostly commodity funds, hedge funds, and other instruments issued in the interbank market or the interdealer market. We've seen gold sold every time it's tried to rally. There's been selling by this group of large-scale financial institutions that are speculating in a whole variety of markets, and they're speculating in the gold market from a bearish point of view. Every time gold tries to rally, we have a big influx of selling, much like we've seen in the last few weeks. But meanwhile, physical demand for gold, that is demand for the real thing, not paper-related gold assets, but physical gold demand has been on the rise for a number of years now. And much of that physical demand is coming from the Asian markets, India and China in particular, which are the world's largest national gold markets. Demand each year in each of those countries is between 800 and 1,000 tons. And that goes on fairly regularly, with consistent buying month after month, year after year, as these countries have become wealthier, their gold propensity has grown stronger. And this is gold that's moving into what I call strong hands. The buyers, whether they're private households or investors or the central banks of these countries, they're buying with a very long-term perspective. And they're not going to be eager sellers when the price rises $100 or $200 or even $300, $400. That gold isn't going to come out of these countries. And we're going to find investors in the Western financial markets in the United States and Europe bidding on gold to much, much higher prices as a consequence. So I like to think of the long-term outlook as being exceedingly positive, while the near-term outlook remains somewhat uncertain. But from a long-term perspective, today's prices are a real bargain.
No, it's well said. And I like and appreciate your thought with regard to the longer term focus. If someone purchases shares of Netflix or Tesla Motors, who knows if those shares will exit their account through either a sell stop or a market order in the next few days, weeks, or months. But these folks, particularly in China, have a voracious appetite. It's insatiable year after year, regardless of price. It's quite a positive that with the 3-year sell-off, their appetite has actually increased. The herd tends to shun markets that are declining. That's not the case, as you point out, in India and China, which combined consume over half the world's bullion each year, as you say, close to 1,000 tons.
And in China, you know, the central bank, the People's Bank of China, has been actually promoting private gold ownership. It's made gold more available to more buyers across China than ever before. And I think it has a view that private holdings are, in some fashion, a national asset, even if they're not held by the central bank but are held by the private sector. It's still considered a national asset. And the Chinese, in particular, along with a number of other countries, Russia being another one that comes into this category, are wary of holding more and more dollar-denominated assets as official central bank reserves. And their central banks are using every opportunity they can to buy additional gold reserves in a struggle to reduce their dependence on the U.S. dollar.
You know, CEO Alexsov really underscored and highlighted this idea you bring up regarding perception, the perception of gold, of bullion, of silver, of precious metals in Asia, particularly in China, in India, is so different than here in the West. Eventually, we will have that sea change moment. Unfortunately, it'll likely require some type of dollar meltdown. The key takeaway point, I think, is they have the correct perspective.
Yes, well, these societies have been interested in gold for thousands of years. Their interest isn't going to go away overnight, even if the world economy performs, to everybody's liking. In fact, if the world economy grows to everybody's liking, there'll be an increase in wealth from these gold-friendly countries that will push prices much higher, even in the absence of global financial instability or other problems that typically favor gold.
You know, CEO Alexsov mentioned that during his travels to Hong Kong, lines were wrapped of folks from China all around Hong Kong and retailers. And he pointed out that just a small fraction of the Chinese provinces are even allowed to travel. There's already a glut of imports into China. And now only a small fraction can travel to Hong Kong to purchase it. So what I'm alluding to here is the potential for a tidal wave of demand that could be unleashed gradually over the next few years.
Right, that it doesn't require financial catastrophe around the world. It just requires that these gold-friendly countries continue to buy gold as they have in the past, and more likely they will buy more than they have in the past because they'll have the means to do so. Well, I think one thing for certain is that stock prices on Wall Street and other equity markets around the world are overly expensive. The stock markets have gone higher and higher and higher, and by most measures are today extremely overvalued. So Wall Street is vulnerable to a significant setback, which could come at any time, could be the catalyst that starts gold moving higher again. So I would keep my eye on stock market valuation, particularly in the United States and Europe, but in the developing world as well. And this could be the match that lights the flame.
You know, we recently had Dr. Burton Malkiel, a random walk down Wall Street, and, you know, mirrored your sentiments with regard to the frothiness, particularly of U.S. equities. noting historical P.E. ratios, the CAPE ratio from his colleague, Mr. Schiller, Dr. Schiller, over at Yale. There is certainly frothiness there. And I think that when this love affair with the equities, particularly U.S. equities, starts to wane, and we're already seeing signs of that, so we're getting close. We may be there now. We may be there 6 months from now.
Right. And, you know, the other thing that could trigger a start to the next run-up in gold, or a long-term uptrend in gold, is Federal Reserve policy. The Fed is between a rock and a hard place. It's created record amounts of new money over the last 4 or 5 years through its program of quantitative easing. It's held interest rates at extremely low levels that really don't make sense. And it needs at some point to unwind all of this frothiness that it's pushed into the marketplace. And when that happens, we just don't know what the financial environment will be like. You see, in the past couple of years, talk about rising rates in the United States, that is, rising interest rates, have always triggered a sell-off in gold. And that's likely to continue. But when interest rates do begin to rise, we'll see the consequences. And one consequence will be more interest in gold as a asset, particularly amongst hedge funds and institutional investors who don't want to miss the upside of the stock market. So they're taking their cash and putting in stocks. But when they're a little more worried about equities continuing to rise, they may reevaluate the outlook for gold and start buying gold as a investment asset and hedge, just like others.
This sounds a lot like a gray swan moment. We've seen several of those recently. The U.S. dollar rally, nearly vertical. Very few of my guests correctly called that market. We're approaching 8 or 9 months in this rally, showing very few signs of abating. In addition, we also had a gray swan, if you will, with the oil meltdown recently. Not a lot of folks called that accurately. That, of course, sent the ruble plunging and the price of gold into the stratosphere.
Exactly. You know, one thing that's for sure is that uncertainty will remain high. And typically, markets are moved by events that come out of the blue, the black swan, as you alluded to with your comments a minute ago. Rarely do we see these things coming. In retrospect, you know, we can say, aha, it made perfect sense. But ahead of time, one just doesn't know. And that's why I like to focus on long-term investing in gold, irrespective of what we may think about the short-term outlook.
And on those words, we will wrap up the discussion today. Jeffrey Nichols, Managing Director of American Precious Metals Advisors and Senior Economist to Rosalind Capital. I wonder if you could tell us more, please, about the services you provide and share any contact information.
Basically, my firm is a consultant to major players in precious metals markets. By that, I mean, over the years, we've counted a number of central banks as clients, jewelry manufacturers, mining companies, institutional investors. We've counseled these companies on not just price prospects, but on business development, long-term marketing efforts. We've done a lot of work over the years with a number of national mints, the Austrian Mint being one, the Royal Canadian Mint being another, who have been clients at times when they've tried to develop the market for their own coin in the U.S. and or global marketplace, and we've helped them do that. So from the point of view of your readers and listeners, it's unlikely that we have services for them. You know, we don't do anything for the retail investor. Rosalind is a client of mine. They have been almost from the beginning of their firm, and they've looked to us for help in marketing and in price forecasting and a whole variety of things. They're a great company with great leadership. The gold world is full of companies that are maybe not entirely on the up and up, and I'm very careful in choosing clients who I have confidence in, who I have faith in, who I think are trustworthy, worthy of doing business with. So, you know, I could endorse Roslyn Capital quite strongly. They're a great group of people. I do produce a periodic report on whatever I think is interesting in the gold market. It's called nickelsongold.com. And if your listeners and readers are interested in following the gold market, they might take a look at nickelsongold.com. But much of that information is also available on the Roslyn website.
Very good. Well, Jeffrey Nichols, thanks for taking time for us today. We'll look forward to hearing your thoughts again on GoldSeek.com radio.
Thanks so much, Chris. It's been delightful talking with you.